Okay, hi everyone, this is Lahir from ABCs of Anaesthesia, and today we're going to go through a blood gas. But we're going to go through it not in the super detailed way, but the way an anaesthetist looks at a blood gas. Everything is really time critical, so what we have to do is we have to get a really quick grasp of what's going on at the life-threatening stuff and be able to treat it straight away. So, this blood gas was from a fractured knock patient having a hemiarthroplasty, and they were 84. They were pretty unwell overall with some liver disease and some previous cardiac disease. We took it just a standard blood gas just to see what was going on. Anyway, so I'm here with my Reg here, and she's going to just explain what she goes through with this gas.
Okay, so the first thing I do when I look at a gas is just check that it's the right patient,
nice.
What time the gas has been taken, and so I can compare it with previous gases if they're there.
And that's so important, isn't it? Because it's like, especially in those big multi-trauma cases where you're getting massive blood loss, you're taking gas every 15 minutes and you really want to have a chronological order and know exactly what you're doing.
Absolutely.
But also in exams, you want to be mentioning this, otherwise, you know, these are marks for jam, really.
Yeah, absolutely.
Good.
Just check that it is arterial and what FiO2 the patient was on when the gas was taken.
Fantastic.
Or refer to what the patient's on.
Great. Keep going.
Yeah, okay. The next question that I ask myself always is what's going to kill the patient first? So I want to know about oxygenation. And
yep.
If the PaO2, I look at the PaO2 here, mm-hmm. which is 290, and I'm very reassured the mm-hmm. patient has safe oxygenation.
Fantastic. And I think they were on, was it an FI of
50?
Yeah, 50%.
Yep.
So that's actually really great. So how do you know? So safe PaO2 is above 70 technically, but
mm-hmm.
you know, we'd want it above 100 realistically.
Yep.
But say it's above 100, but there's, you know, how do you know what to expect?
So you're looking kind of for an AA gradient. So, you know, on the one hand, as you said, you're looking for safe. So you're on that nice flat part of the oxygen dissociation hemoglobin curve.
Yep.
But you also want to know, is this the oxygen I expect for the FiO2 that I'm on?
Great.
So about the rule of thumb is that 3 to 5 times the FiO2 the patient's on is what you should expect.
Mm-hmm.
So if the patient's on 50, I expect, you know, 250 or above, that's helpful to know that this patient actually has great oxygenation
yeah.
with no AA gradient.
I'm almost surprised that's 290. I'm almost thinking maybe we took a gas when the FiO2 is actually 70 or
probably,
something.
Probably, yeah. I think we were playing with it a bit at
that's
that
right.
time.
Okay, so let's say, even though the patient's safe, but so let's say the PaO2 is 290 and the patient is completely safe, but maybe I was on 100% oxygen, so I'm expecting, you know, 300 to 500,
yeah.
So then I've got a problem. I've got an AA gradient, even though the patient's safe. So what am I thinking of then?
Yeah, I mean, that would be mild, but if the PaO2 is much lower than what you would expect, you're worried about something like VQ mismatch or diffusion problem or an issue with shunt or something. So there's
yep.
a lung issue, let's say aspiration, atelectasis,
yep.
A PE or something. Something bad's happening to the patient's lungs,
absolutely.
Probably.
And at least we know some process is happening. Sometimes they've already had that problem. Maybe they're already a COPD patient. They already had lung disease. And other times you're like, okay, why has that changed suddenly? We're going to look into it. We're going to do all the other investigations that you need to do. Auscultate, suctioning, chest x-ray, whatever it is, get them to CT after the operation.
Yep.
Good, so that's probably enough of the PaO2. That's quickly what we think about and what we look at.
Yep.
Keep going.
So the next would be looking at the pH. I want to know if this pH is grossly abnormal.
Mm-hmm.
Reassuringly, this pH is normal. It's 7.418.
Beautiful.
With a range of 7.35 to 7.45.
Yep.
I'm looking to see whether there is any disturbance in the respiratory system, which is the PCO2.
Mm-hmm.
There isn't. It's low.
Exactly. And so something we were talking about before was that if the PaCO2 is the cause of it, if it's, you know, above 45, if it's quite high, what do you make of that as an anaesthetist?
I'm not that worried about it in an anaesthetized patient because I know that's probably because of me.
Yep.
I'm in control of the patient's ventilation if they're yep. having a general anaesthetic generally, if it's a relaxant GA, so I can manage that
mm-hmm.
by changing the ventilator settings or improving the ventilation if the patient's spot breathing.
Beautiful. And,
yep.
and that's right, so, you know, high respiratory acidosis is forgivable. You can overventilate them later, so you can correct this in minutes to hours to days. And so even if the PaCO2 is 100, because of whatever reason, depending on the reason, depending on the problem, I can easily fix that.
Yeah.
So what else
generally,
do you
think about? Yeah. So then the next thing is that's probably more concerning is if the patient has a low pH and the bicarbonate or the base excess is really low,
mm-hmm.
then I'm worried that this is a metabolic acidosis, and that's something that's usually worth worrying about. There's
yes.
something not quite right with this patient.
Uh-huh.
We need to figure out what it is.
Great, so I look straight away at the base excess. The base excess is the pure acid component of your problem, so a really large negative number. I'm really worried, especially if you've got a really low pH. And quickly, the causes I think of are DULE, so diabetic ketoacidosis, uremia, lactic acidosis, and ethanol and other alcohol type poisonings. Mm. So I immediately go through those things, check for the anion gap to make sure that that is the cause of it, and then try to solve it as we need to.
Yeah, absolutely.
Cool. So that's your blood gas stuff. Now there's only a few other sections here, and again, you can go through blood gas in such detail, but again, we're about getting the critical stuff, the life-threatening stuff, and sort and identifying it and sorting it out. So what do you look for next?
So I'd look at the hemoglobin next, especially during surgery, just to check that it hasn't acutely dropped and could be the cause of, let's say, a lactic acidosis from, you know, hypovolemia or bleeding.
Sounds good.
The next thing I'd look at is generally the potassium,
yep,
especially looking for hyperkalaemia, as that's obviously a life-threatening problem and something we should treat.
And so I guess if the potassium is greater than 5.5, I'm worried that stuff's going on. In anaesthesia, it's really important because we often give succinylmethonium, and that can, increase the potassium, up to 0.5 to 1 millimole per liter. But even more if it's a burns patient or a critical care myopathy patient or any kind of myopathy patient. And just quickly, potassium. There's many ways to handle it. And on the ward, you're often giving slow-acting stuff. We're all about fast-acting treatments.
Yeah, very impatient.
That's right. So what would you give?
So I'd stabilize the cardiac membrane with calcium chloride, unless it was contraindicated, with, 10 millimoles of calcium chloride.
Beautiful.
In a big vein that, with a good drip. Mm-hmm. And then I would give salbutamol as inhaled salbutamol or insulin and dextrose.
Fantastic.
You can theoretically also give bicarbonate, which I haven't done clinically, and potentially institute dialysis if all that fails.
That's right. And I've never had to do this, but I always think of that situation. What happens if you just can't get the potassium under control? Is maybe it's a circumstance where I've got to do everything to shift the potassium, but really the treatment is getting the potassium out of the body. And all those treatments, so your calcium is to stabilize, insulin is to shift potassium, and dextrose as well, salbutamol is to shift potassium, sodium bicarbonate is to shift potassium. I'm actually removing it from the body, so maybe I need to insert a VAS cath and get the ICU guys to help me hemodialyze the patient.
Yep.
Great, what else do you think
of? I guess the last thing would be, glucose, really. Mm-hmm. You want to check for a significant hypoglycemia, which needs treatment, and it's something that shouldn't be ignored, and also significant hyperglycemia. We're not into tight glucose control here, so something under 10, 4 to 10, I'm pretty happy.
Yeah, realistically, if you aim for just, decent control, it's far better, you get far less hypos. Let's say the glucose in this patient, so it's normal, it's 4.5, but if it was, say, 1 or 2, what would you do?
Yeah, so I think I'd treat this with 50% or 25% dextrose, and then run a dextrose infusion, let's say 10 or 5% dextrose infusion, and check very regularly, probably pop in an ART line.
Great.
And check that regularly.
Sounds good. Hey, that's a very quick ABG reading for this patient. Again, with anaesthesia, it's all about the stuff that's really life-threatening, so all I need to do after identifying the patient and the time, check the pH, make sure it's not a metabolic acidosis, make sure your O2 is safe, HB, potassium, and glucose. And that's a quick reading of the ABG. Thanks, guys. See you next time.
Bye.